Hey folks, Randy Newberg here. Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Leupold's Hunt Talk Radio. I know in our last podcast, I told you that Corey Jacobson would be on this podcast with me, but Corey wanted to figure out how he could get out of a podcast, I think. So what he did is when we were in New Mexico, the last evening he shot a bull elk and we didn't get that thing out of the canyon into camp until about, I think we got back to camp at 2 a.m. and then we had to race to an airport to catch flights. So Corey got out of a podcast, but he did say he was going to take a rain check and that he'd come to Montana and we'd do a day by day of what happened on that hunt in New Mexico. So I'm going to hold him to that. But in the interim, I'm home in Montana here for a couple days. And lucky for me, one of our previous guests was in town speaking. And you've heard him twice on this podcast. And it was at the suggestion of a conservation group who's hosting him. That conservation group called me and said, Randy, why don't you guys do a podcast with us while he's here? So that's what we're going to do today. Sorry, Corey. Too bad for you. But anyhow, I just want to quickly thank all of our sponsors of this podcast before we get into the real crux and discussion that you're going to hear today. As I said, Leupold is now the title sponsor of this podcast, and I can't thank them enough. They're the title sponsor of everything we do. They are just so supportive of the self-guided, the public land, the all the things that we do, the message we have. Leupold is a brand that is born in the hunting industry, born and pretty much raised, I guess, through the hunting world. And their products reflect that. The other sponsors, Orion Coolers, just back from New Mexico, and we really put them to the test. 10 days of putting those coolers out in the New Mexico heat and still had frozen milk jugs when we left. I don't know how else to say it other than go to orioncoolers.com. You're going to find them. And when you start using them, you're going to understand why I'm a big fan of Orion Coolers. Then right now, the other company you hear me talk about a lot is Onyx Maps. They have a promo going right now where if you go out to their website, onyxmaps.com, and all the details are out there. I can't explain them all here, but we're doing a hunt giveaway with them where next year, 2017, somebody is going antelope hunting in New Mexico in Catron County with me and Matt Seidel from Onyx Maps. So go to onyxmaps.com and they're promoting their new hunt app, which is a smartphone app. And the details of how you get in on that drawing are all out at onyxmaps.com. And if you buy any of their hunt app products, make sure and use the promo code Randy16, R-A-N-D-Y-1-6, and you're going to get 20% off any of the app products. Not the chips, but the smartphone apps. So, great product. You'll see why I don't leave home without it. And then also, one of the biggest sponsors of this podcast is GoHunt.com. You've heard me talk about it. We've done a bunch of videos about it on our YouTube channel. I have file cabinets full of research material here in my office, but the one place I've migrated to for just about all of my research, draw odds, unit descriptions, overview of each state's system, how the drawing works, changes from last year, all that stuff, is GoHunt.com. They have a program called The Insider. And if you go and you sign up for their service, The Insider service, right now we've got a new promo going with them that if you use the promo code Randy, R-A-N-D-Y, you're going to get a $50 Sportsman's Warehouse gift card when you sign up for the GoHunt.com Insider service. So go to gohunt.com/insider, use promo code Randy, and get yourself a $50 Sportsman's Warehouse gift card. One other thing, before we get into this podcast, There is, we're in this really tall conference room. It's got a really tall ceiling. So when I was doing the testing of the mics, before we turn the mics on, there's a bad echo going on in here when all three mics are running. So I apologize in advance if that echo picks up on these microphones. We'll do our best to get it out of there, but it's not going to be perfect, but I think you're going to find the discussion worthwhile. So with that, no further ado, as they say. I told you it was a surprise guest, that it wasn't Corey Jacobson. Like I, in the previous podcast, I lied to you and said it was going to be Corey this time, but Corey shot his elk so late the last night, we didn't get out of camp until get to camp till two in the morning. And then we didn't get to Albuquerque in time to do a podcast. So we got better guests today than Corey anyhow. Corey is just going to sit there and talk about elk calling and how many elk he shoots and how bad of a caller I am. So I thought we'd do something special. I'm back in Bozeman for 3 days. And my good friend Gray Thornton, who is the president and CEO of the Wild Sheep Foundation, sent me a text and said, "Hey, Shane Mahoney's going to be in town. Can you make it for a podcast?" I'm like, "Can I? I'll be right there." So now you know who's on our podcast this morning.
Good to be with you, Randy.
Oh, great. Thanks for being here, Shane. Thanks again. This is your third appearance. You might want to just take over this podcast.
Well, thank you for having me back.
Oh, thanks for being here.
Thanks to Gray for including me in this.
Yeah, and like I said, Gray is the president and CEO of the Wild Sheep Foundation. Shane, many of you have listened to him, you've read him, you've followed him on Facebook, you've heard him on our podcast. He founded his organization called Conservation Visions. And it would take most of this podcast to talk about all the things Shane is involved in, so we'll just touch on them as we go along. That work?
Yeah, that's super. Just fine.
Anyhow, if I wish we were doing this as a video podcast, because I'm sitting here at the world headquarters. Do you call it the galactic headquarters?
No, just the world headquarters.
All right. Of the Wild Sheep Foundation. And there are sheep of all sorts on the wall, and since I'm in the less than one club, I've never drawn a sheep tag, let alone shot a sheep. Sitting here looking at all this is quite remarkable. And how long have you guys been in Bozeman now?
We came here, Randy, in May with the full team, but we had kind of an advanced crew that came out July of last year. So okay. We've been in Bozeman with a presence a little over a year. The full team here since May, and just absolutely loving it. We've just had such a great welcome from the Bozeman community, from the Montana community, and I would very, very pleased to say this is our home.
Yeah,
this is our home. We love it.
As someone who lives here, I'm glad you're here.
Well, we are too.
When you guys were in Cody, I used to go to your headquarters down there, and I'd walk around and think about, man, I'd look at those maps that talk about, and I'm referring to this one on the wall over here, of what used to be endemic or native sheep habitat, then what it shrunk to, and where it is today. I mean, conservation, if there's an example of conservation, it's very evident in the world of wild sheep.
You know, Randy, you look and, of course, we've got one of the foremost authority, and I would say the foremost authority on the North American conservation model here with Shane Mahoney. But when you look at all the comeback success that we've had since the late 1890s, you look at wild turkey and you look at wild sheep, and those are two of the most critical comeback success that shows the contribution of the hunter conservationists.
Yeah.
Bottom line, we wouldn't have wild sheep in North America if we didn't have the hunter. We wouldn't have wild turkey in North America if we didn't have the hunter. You're looking, we've got a map that we did with the Western Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies, and it shows the distribution of bighorn sheep at the turn of the century. In the turn of the century, I'm talking about, 1800s, right, and 1900s.
Yeah.
And there were estimates of 1 to 2, maybe even more, million bighorn sheep in North America. As a matter of fact, when Lewis and Clark made their way west, bighorn sheep were one of the most numerous animals that they came across.
Right.
Our expansion, unregulated hunting, and we'll certainly talk more about that in the podcast on how it, you know, how our forefathers with Roosevelt and Grinnell made some unbelievable changes. But unregulated hunting, market hunting, feeding a growing westward moving right. nation, and primarily disease that was brought to wild sheep from domestic stock, domestic sheep and goats that wild sheep, bighorn sheep in particular, were naive to. It's kind of like the smallpox coming from Europe to Native Americans. That's right. That's what it did to bighorn sheep. Randy, we were down to in the 1950s, 60s, early 70s about 25,000 bighorn sheep in North America.
So when I was born in 1964, am I the youngest guy on this podcast?
You are.
All right.
You are.
All right.
And you look good.
But I'm the grayest guy on the podcast. How does that work?
I don't think you own that.
Shane is claiming that title.
Is that? And my name's Gray. So, you know.
Well, so we got to go on.
Gray.
Yeah. So
yeah, there is.
When I was born in November 1964, how many sheep were in the lower 48?
About 25,000.
25,000.
And we've got over 80,000 today. So 80, a threefold 000. Increase.
In my lifetime.
From those lows.
Wow.
Threefold increase.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is exceptional. And that's, you know, and that's due to the interest, mm-hmm. The passion, and bottom line, the conservation dollars of organizations like Wild Sheep Foundation, our many chapters and affiliates, and the state and provincial agencies that we work yeah. with to bring those numbers back.
Yeah. And I just think about that. I try to make it tangible to people to understand that conservation is something that's happening during their life.
Yeah.
And that's why I use that example there of there are more than three times as many sheep today as when I was born. And if you look at a map of where they're distributed and spread out, it's geographically their occupying range is probably even more than three times that because yeah. you guys have done great work in putting them back in this range, back in that canyon, back where they were, whereas probably when I was born, they were in pretty small, concentrated local areas, which all the biologists tell me, high concentrations of bighorn sheep is not necessarily a healthy population.
You know, our senior conservation director, Kevin Hurley, has got a saying. I don't know if I like it, but it's true. He says, wild sheep and bighorn sheep are born looking for a place to die. And it is an amazing, you know, you look at where wild sheep live, you know, you look at the environment, the rocks, the ice, the snow, the wind, the cold.
The heat of the desert.
And the heat of the desert. You know, it's amazing that they, as such a hardy animal to the elements, can be so susceptible to disease.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah. No, it's a remarkable comeback success story, and there's a couple of notable comebacks. Montana's doing pretty well. Nevada is an amazing story. There was yeah. basically in the 1960s, there was a remnant population of bighorns and desert bighorns.
Really?
A remnant, you know, I mean, yeah. we're talking less than 1,000, you know, probably in the hundreds, they really don't know, but a remnant population, there's now over 11,000 bighorn sheep, desert bighorn sheep in Nevada.
Wow.
Texas is an interesting one, completely sure. different model in how they brought them back, but Texas has the same number of desert bighorn sheep today that they had when Europeans came across Texas.
Yeah.
So they've brought those numbers. They never had a huge population, but they've brought those numbers up to about 1,800, 2,000 desert bighorn sheep.
Well, in West Texas, obviously.
On ranches in West Texas.
Yeah.
And that is absolutely 100% the work of hunter conservationists, Texas Bighorn Society, Texas Parks and Wildlife, Wild Sheep Foundation, interested conservationists that put sheep on the mountain, which is, you know, of course, has been our motto for many, many years. And then we put them there, And we started to see that even that wasn't enough. We got to keep them there.
Right.
So that's what Wild Sheep Foundation does, puts and keeps wild sheep on the mountain.
And does it very well. And Shane, you and I, in our prior discussions and in places we've bumped into each other, you've spoke eloquently about the importance of the citizen conservationist to this whole North American model. Mm-hmm. And what Gray has just laid out there is, to me anyhow, a very obvious example of how citizen conservationists have made a difference. And yeah, in this case, we're talking about wild sheep, but it could be any species, game or non-game.
Yeah. I mean, I think the remarkable successes that we've had across so many elements of conservation, they really are miraculous, right? The achievements are so many. The land that has been protected, the wildlife that's been recovered, the economy that's been generated, all under this, you know, free access to wildlife largely kind of model that's unique to North America. And it began, of course, with individual citizens in the latter part of the, you know, the 1800s, who faced with almost unbelievable odds,
yeah,
decided that they simply would not allow wildlife to disappear. And, you know, we had a circumstance at that time, let's put ourselves with them, you know, we had a circumstance with no state agencies, no federal agencies,
no funding mechanism,
no funding mechanism, no enforcement to speak of,
yeah,
no game laws really to speak of in a way. We didn't have any university programs. we didn't have any.
All the things we take for granted,
right,
today.
Right.
Absolutely. And so,
And often gripe about.
Yeah.
They had none of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you see that it all began in the hearts and minds of citizens. And they simply, you know, had a dream that wildlife would not disappear. When the Boone and Crockett Club, you know, held its first display of heads and horns, as it was called, you know, one of the great motivations for doing that was because they thought that the citizens of America would never see these animals again. And very few people realized that. And of course, they had good reasons to be concerned. They saw the bison had disappeared. Pronghorn were extremely low. Elk were restricted to a few tiny places. They needed the U.S. cavalry to come into Yellowstone to protect some of the last remnants of elk on the continent, or certainly in the United States. So they, you know, they really saw a circumstance that was dire for wildlife. And, you know, Gray and I floated the Yellowstone for 10 miles on Sunday. You know, and we see elk, and we see mountain sheep, and we see pronghorn antelope. I mean, just in a casual kind of drift down this river.
Yeah.
And to think that at one time it was truly believed that we would never see those species again. And we've carried that inspiration. Certainly the hunter conservationist movement has carried it, but, you know, there have been others who have not hunted, who have carried this as well, who have been inspired by the idea of conservation. And ultimately, the only hope we have for these wild others that share the planet with us, and some of which we see represented in this room, is if individual citizens care enough to do the right things for them. And that may mean supporting organizations that do really good conservation work. It may mean being vocal about decisions that a particular government wishes to make that impinges negatively upon wildlife resources and wild places and land and waters.
Yeah.
And I believe that, you know, in all the historical reflections on the achievements of Theodore Roosevelt, who arguably was the most effective, conservationist maybe of all time,
right,
in terms of his legacy,
right.
You know, I think that, you know, we talk about his, you know, the amount of land that he set aside, and we talk about all of the laws he tried to bring in and the closing down of market hunting, and all of those achievements were extraordinary. But I think his greatest achievement was that he somehow inspired in the American people this idea that conservation really mattered.
Right.
That national parks were a good idea, that wildlife refuges were a good idea.
Yeah.
That stopping people from slaughtering shorebirds was a good idea. And that, you know, believing in keeping wildlife with us for generations that were unborn at the time was a noble enough and realistic enough
a dream that the country should set itself to this task. And it's one of the most remarkable things as a non-American, looking back at that era. You know, when he left the White House, he wasn't the most popular man in government by any means.
No, they were happy to be rid of him in D.C.
They were. Yeah. And of course, they talked about many of these policies that he brought in, you know, keeping wildlife sort of in the public trust and, you know, having it for all citizens and all these kinds of things, shutting down the big machines of market hunting and many people who were very influential and involved in that business. And yet the really interesting thing is not since his first successor, not since Taft's time onward to the current president, Obama, and undoubtedly we hope for future presidents, nobody has dared tear down what he built.
Right.
We do have some challenges coming forward. And why is that? Why has no president, no government, you know, since that time decided that all these ideas should remain when they had the power to change them? And I think the reason is because somehow they sense that in the hearts and minds of the American citizen, these things really mattered.
Yeah.
And you best tinker with something else. And so I think this citizen conservation thing is still very much alive. And we need, of course, more people to care.
Right.
And we need people to bring them to a point of caring. And it would be my hope that the hunter conservationist movement would, you know, form the inspiration for that. And lead all citizens to the idea of putting and keeping sheep on the mountain and elk in alpine meadows and caribou on the northern tundras and so on, you know.
Yeah. The point you just said there, Shane, makes me think about kind of the obvious and then the subtle is the members of the Wild Sheep Foundation, let's face it, or the Elk Foundation or Ducks Unlimited, whatever group you want to say, they are this citizen conservationist. And we're at that point where, because what's the percentage of hunters in America? 5%?
About 4.7%.
Yeah, of America are
right,
hunters.
Right.
So the burden on each of us is much larger than it was 30 years ago, 60 years ago, 100 years ago. And not everybody, I don't think it's realistic that everybody's going to buy into the hunting conservation model, because a lot of people just, they're not going to become hunters. But how do we provide that leadership example so that they become conservationists, even if they're not hunter conservation? I don't care if they're hunter conservationists, fisherman conservationists, or just conservationists because, as Shane was referring to, they have this connection that Roosevelt brought us. Was conservation even a term or an idea?
No,
prior to his time?
We didn't even have such a term in the English language, but there are some precursors to it, of course,
right.
You know, as you translate ideas from,
yeah,
from different languages, but there's no doubt that he set the ship afloat, right?
Yeah.
It was on dry dock before it existed at all.
So I'm trying to figure out, if we're going to be a society that continues this passion for wild things and wild places, how do we as hunters continue to be this example in a period of time where there's all this conflict about hunting and misunderstanding about hunting? And I'll say that we share some of the blame for the misunderstanding in how we represent ourselves and for maybe not telling our story, maybe not being good at marketing, if you want to call it that. We're good at conservation, but we're not good at telling our story.
Right.
How do we as hunters, whether you're a member of Wild Sheep or whoever, I'm just in my mind, and I don't have the answer, but I'm trying to figure out, how do I get the listener to understand that they really are the key to where this is going?
You know, it's interesting, Randy. We, you know, we've got to look for common ground. We hosted, Wild Sheep Foundation hosted a, with our friends, backcountry hunters and anglers, a green drinks event.
Like green beer.
like green beer, but it was, hey, bring your own cup and we'll provide free beer.
Yeah.
And other beverages and food. But we invited the conservation community, and I'd also say we invited the non-consumptive environmental community mm-hmm. to the Wild Sheep Foundation headquarters. We had later, as we figured out, we had about 2/3 non-hunters and a third hunter. But what we talked about, and we talked about wild places, we talked about public lands, we talked about wildlife, we talked about what we share in common, not what we fight over.
Right.
Very interesting. We were, Randy, you and I were chatting a little bit earlier this morning. We had actually 3 PETA members
at your green drinks
at this green drinks event. Huh. We welcomed them. Obviously, we are about as far apart on many issues as possible. But in this case, we were talking about wildlife and our love for it, their need for wild places, our need for wild places,
yeah.
You know, our spiritual need for wild places. And you know what? They got that. And yeah. Again, I don't think we, they wouldn't turn my mind. I didn't turn their mind, nor did anyone else at the event. But they did walk away and mention to us, a couple of people that were there, that he goes, you know, they walked away with a little different understanding of our community. So
yeah.
Shane Mahoney is here in Bozeman now. He is speaking tonight. Wild Sheep Foundation is hosting a conservation night with Shane Mahoney uh-huh. and the Wild Harvest Initiative. We have invited, it's open to the public event. We've invited the Bozeman Conservation, Environmental, and bottom line, anyone that would like to come. To hear him tonight. So that, you know, that's going to be a great event, and that's looking for common ground.
Right.
We're not going to force hunting down anyone's
right.
throat, but we're going to talk about what we do, and if there's anyone that can show the relevance of our community to the non-consumptive community, it's Shane Mahoney, in
yeah.
my opinion. So,
we're
looking for another, you know, another great event this evening. And the whole thing is outreach, and the whole thing is right. looking for common ground.
Yeah. And that's the whole common ground thing. I don't know how conservation has a future led by hunters if we don't look for that common ground. If we think we're just going to circle the wagons, we're not going to get there. In today's world,
no, in fact, we didn't get where we are. In fact, without help from a lot of other people.
Yeah.
You know, I think a reading of world history and military history in particular convinces almost anyone that any retreat to fortress is doomed.
That's,
you know,
history has that example in yeah, many places.
Yeah. So yeah. I think we kind of realize, or we should realize this. And I think we also should take inspiration from the founding fathers, if you will, of this country, but also the founding fathers of the conservation movement, because it was extremely inclusive at the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people remember the founding of the Boone and Crockett Club in 1887 as a seminal event in conservation, and it certainly was. What not as many people know, perhaps, is the fact that one of the founding members, George Bird Grinnell, who was the editor of Forest and Stream for decades and fought almost every conservation issue on this continent effectively, you know, came one day to Roosevelt and said, you know, we've established this thing for game species, you know, the big game species, as the hunted mammals and so
right.
forth were called. And he said, but you know, we really need to do something now to protect and conserve the non-game species. And he actually used that term.
Mm-hmm.
Most people think non-game programs came into the state agencies and provincial agencies in Canada and the United States in the 1960s or 70s.
Right.
But that term was actually used by Grinnell. And so Grinnell actually founded the Audubon Society.
Right. And so few people understand that.
Yeah.
One of our greatest hunter conservationists founded the Audubon Society.
He did.
Yeah.
And of course, he had been homeschooled by John James Audubon's widow.
Right.
But also, the reason why that gained momentum so quickly was, of course, Roosevelt immediately said, of course we should do this, because Again, many people don't realize that people who knew Roosevelt closely said he cared about two things more than anything else. One was his family, and the other were birds.
Yeah.
The first wildlife refuge he established was Pelican Island. It wasn't something for elk or, you know what I mean? It was for these birds. So, you know, we had this kind of inclusive tradition. Then John Muir, in founding Sierra Club, came to the Boone and Crockett Club for help on his issues.
Yeah.
And Roosevelt and the Boone and Crockett Club said, John, we're tied up so tightly with the Yellowstone issue, you know. We're trying to make this a reality. It's on the books, but, you know, we still have people stealing in there and poaching and all this. We just can't help you. You need to go, form your own organization. So the idea that somehow we shouldn't always be together, those of common mind who care for wildlife, this is something that happened in between the original revolution that founded the movement and the present day.
Right.
Because in the founding days, that was not the case. Anyone who cared for wildlife was welcomed into this tent.
Right.
And a lot of people perhaps don't realize that the conservation movement that led to the end of the slaughter of shorebirds and wading birds at a time when egret's feathers were worth more than a pound of gold,
wow,
by same weight, just as rhino horn is today,
yeah,
they don't realize that it was the women's movement who were struggling to gain the right to vote in this country, who joined in this campaign, both because of their concern for wildlife and also they wanted to demonstrate that they took serious issues seriously and would campaign for them, and thereby demonstrate their legitimacy as citizens, as strange as we think of that now.
Right.
And so we had this wonderfully complicated soup of all kinds of different people who were involved in this. And what we're really talking about when we talk about inclusivity, and what we really talk about when you see the overtures that, you know, the Wild Sheep Foundation is making, et cetera, is trying to recapture the glorious ideals that founded our movement in the first instance.
Yeah.
What always has amazed me about our own world, you know, the hunter conservationist world, is how we sometimes seem to be afraid of this wider coalition instead of taking it upon ourselves to be the leaders in its forging.
Yeah.
And this is an opportunity lost for the hunters of America and the anglers of America.
Yeah.
And I think it will be a shame. Someone is going to emerge in our countries, in Canada and the United States, who will reignite this common citizen passion for wildlife. And if the hunting and angling communities are not up to the task,
someone else will.
Then someone else will.
Yeah, for sure. Gray, does it bother you that the expert on American conservation history is from Canada? I always am, and I don't mean this in any bad way, Shane, but it's like, why don't we know this as well as Shane does?
Every time I get with Shane, there's another little nugget that I come away with and go, how come I haven't read that elsewhere?
Right.
We appreciate you, Shane.
Well, yeah, thank you,
and I don't
I
know
appreciate
if it's,
you as well.
I mean, obviously, Canada has a lot of parallels with the United States. Mm-hmm. That's why we call it the North American model, because of all that.
You bet. Look at sheep. Look at the work that the Wild Sheep Foundation does in both countries.
I mean, Mexico.
And Mexico, yeah.
You know, we talked about putting sheep on the mountain. Bighorn sheep in the lower 48 has Canada to thank. Mm-hmm. British Columbia in particular. We started moving sheep out of British Columbia in the 1940s. And since then...
Really?
There has been over 22,000 bighorn sheep trapped, transplanted in over 1,500 direct actions since the 1940s.
By the Wild Sheep Foundation and your conservation partners, the entire
conservation community.
Yeah.
Yes, and after we formed in 1977, and so, you know, quite a bit has happened since then. But, you know, this whole concept, and you start looking at those trap and transplants maps, I mean, it almost looks like a Southwest airline, you know.
The back of the magazine.
It really does. It looks like the map. And, you know, quite frankly, we also made some mistakes back then.
What do you mean by that?
As Kevin Hurley would say, we'd put round sheep in a square hole. You know, we were moving sheep from a certain environment and putting them into an environment that maybe that's not, you know, they might have been a, you know, kind of a resident group that would only move around in a relatively limited area. And we may put them in an area that they had to go and forage elsewhere for water or for food. And as he pointed out before, they may clump together and there might have been a disease agent that was brought in, whether it was a domestic sheep, a goat or something like that. And we lose them. So, yeah. You know, but that's also wildlife management. You know, it's a system of learning. We're learning more now on the disease issue. Mm-hmm. There was a school of thought and Wild Sheep Foundation is quite frankly, from a funding standpoint, has been at the forefront of funding disease research and finding out what really is the problem here. And we've got an endowed chair at Washington State University that has been working this issue for years. It's the Wild Sheep Foundation Rocky Crate Chair. And we thought for a great deal of time that it's a bug, a bacteria called Mannheimia hemolytica. That certainly is a problematic pathogen in wild sheep, but conventional wisdom today, current research today, says that what it really is a setup agent called Mycoplasma ovipositor, or MOV for short.
MOV.
MOV.
How do you spell that?
MOV.
Yeah, I've seen it as MOVII or something.
MOVI.
MOVI. Okay.
Yeah, and I don't ask me to spell Mycoplasma ovipositor. I'm gonna battle on that one. But bottom line, what MOV does is it sets up wild sheep, bighorns and thin horns, for to being receptive to other pathogens. It basically lays down the cilia in the esophagus. You know, we cough up things daily, you know, hourly, minute, you know.
Right.
Sheep have the same, you know, they have the same mechanism to cough up things that would be problematic. What Mycoplasma ovipositor does is lay down that cilia and allow other pathogens like Mannheimia hemolytica and others to come in and then cause pneumonia. So, you know, here's an evolving science. Again, the thought now is if we can eliminate MOV in wild sheep, that's about a 90% to 97% solution on the disease issue.
Really?
Now, how are we going to do that? That's probably a whole other podcast with people that got propellers spinning on multiple sides of their head, and I'm not one of them. But Wild Sheep Foundation is looking at some things that we can do. We're working with Montana State University right now on MOV-free domestic sheep.
So the domestic sheep would not have it, so they couldn't transmit it. They wouldn't be a vector.
Exactly. Will that be feasible and practical on a large scale public land grazing scenario of thousands of head of domestic sheep? Probably not. Mm-hmm. Interesting enough, in Montana, one of the largest impediments to us increasing the number of bighorns in Montana is finding safe places to put bighorns.
Right.
What constitutes an unsafe place? Well, Wild Sheep Foundation, amazingly enough, here's our mission to put and keep sheep on the mountain, and we actually opposed a transplant of bighorns into the Bridgers.
Right, because there's hobby sheep herds all around the base of the Bridgers,
so,
everywhere.
You know, great, we put those sheep up in the mountains, we've just given them a death sentence.
Right.
That doesn't make sense. Now, those sheep are often private lands. They're small producers, they're hobby flocks. They could be 4-H, you know, it could be some young kids, with their 4-H lamb.
Right.
Wow, if we could incentivize from using market incentives of why don't you put MOV-free sheep on that little private farm flock?
Right.
Or why don't that, you know, we get with the 4-H, which we've done. Mm-hmm. We've talked to the state director and he says, man, this is in our wheelhouse. What if we teach them about MOVE-free lamb?
Yeah.
And they start selling MOVE-free lamb. And then we get back to that hunter conservationist, whether that's the Elk Foundation member, the Ducks Unlimited, Trout Unlimited, or Wild Sheep Foundation, or Mule Deer Foundation member, and say, hey, guys and gals, here's the issue. And when you go to that 4-H sale, pay a premium for an MOVE-free lamb raised by, you know, a young boy or girl.
Yeah.
And you know, it is a movement. So that's it's exciting to us, and we're hanging a lot on this this concept that if MOVE is not present, you know, we've got a 90%+ solution.
Wow.
That can be huge. And then the rest of the things we're doing, Randy, is just, you know, we realize, you know, the West is the West and there's values here. That's why we live here. We love it. You know, domestic sheep producers have been on the land for generations.
Yeah.
You know, Wild Sheep Foundation is not anti-public land grazing.
Yeah.
But we also recognize that not every use is compatible on every single acre.
Exactly.
So, you're not going to, you know, you're probably not going to do a lot of wing shooting in a bird watching area. You know, we're gonna need to find safe places for wild sheep, and then also find places that the domestic sheep industry can be as well.
Right.
A multiple use model.
Yeah. Speaking of that, you know, when we talk about public lands, Shane, I've heard you many times talk about the importance of public lands, and as a non-American, your perspective of what a gift the idea of public lands was to the world. And
I think when I look back on the long arc of conservation history in the United States, you know, the repetitive visits I make to the literature and to, you know, the evidence, doesn't make me any less inspired. It makes me more inspired.
Mm-hmm.
Because some of the outcomes of the movement to establish conservation would have been so unpredictable. I mean, and public lands is one of them. If you think about it, you know, as this nation was being founded, gained its independence and moved forward to become a country, you know, it had a lot of ideals that it was carrying with it. The idea, for example, that man should have dominion. You know, this country was founded by deeply religious people who
right.
came to this country originally to have their religion respected and mm-hmm. to be free to practice it. But those religions, you know, obviously carried the idea that man was in charge and the taking of natural resources and wildlife in particular was his domain. But you also, in America, of course, had this extraordinarily young country that believed in the idea of subduing the wilderness. I mean, the Jeffersonian idea that, you know, the country will be built on yeoman farmers, essentially,
yeah.
you know.
Right.
And it was, to an appreciable extent.
Yeah.
And so the idea that, you know, again, things should be unfettered and the individual should matter and the individual should be able to take what they wanted. But then, you know, all of a sudden, and of course the problems of excessive killing, the market hunting of wildlife. And what does this country do? This country, you know, sets up a system where things are open to everyone and where vast areas of land are not kept off limits, but in fact protected in a sense in that they rest within the public domain
yeah.
and all individuals have access to them. And what does that do? I mean, whether one's a hunter or an angler is not the issue. It's the fact that that inheritance of America, of the American citizenry, of these great public lands where they can recreate in whichever way they want to. They can ice climb, they can kayak, they can fly fish, they can just float down a river, they can hike, they can do, you know, bird watch, they can do whatever. And this is one of the extraordinary strengths of the American conservation system. Now, fortunately, in large parts of Canada, we have this too, to an extent, under a different system of policies. There's a lot of what we call crown land, which
yeah.
is this kind of similar to what we have here. But the American system, it was purposefully designed, right? It was concretely done. And as we all know, there have been, over the last century, periodically this issue is raised and gains a certain level of political currency that, you know, well, maybe it's not such a good idea. Maybe, you know, all those lands should be, these great federal lands, for example, should be taken and transferred to state ownership and so on and so forth. And we all know that there's very different philosophies about what right. would happen in those two circumstances. Yep. And I think this is a jewel in the crown of conservation in the American system. And my own personal view, of course, as a non-American, is that it would be a great step backward to see these public lands infringed upon or lost in any way. I think the country has, you know, despite many challenges, and Gray has just talked about it, you know, how do we make everything work for wildlife, for people, for businesses, and so on. I think the country has done a remarkable job. When you think of the changes that have taken place in the United States of America since 1900,
right.
the numbers of people, the diversity of the community, you know, the changes in technology, the demands on the system, and yet you still have these wondrous lands, you still have this wondrous bounty of wildlife. I mean, this is a miracle every single day. And I think to tamper with miracles is an arrogant thing to do.
I couldn't agree more. And people have heard me go on podcasts here to great length about the public land issue. But to connect that to the topic we mentioned earlier, I don't think it's by accident that the United States has this public land system you refer to, Shane, but also is kind of the cradle of the citizen conservationist. I think there is a connection there that if you don't have places for people to go and interact with nature in the natural world, how can you expect them to be advocates for that cause of wild places and wild things?
Mm-hmm. You know, Randy, I think you nailed it. And earlier on, we were talking, Shane noted and then applauded and then also questioned, you know, isn't it interesting that some of these institutions have not been challenged?
Yeah.
We as U.S. citizens have a birthright.
Yeah.
You know, we have a birthright to these lands and to the wildlife on it. I think our challenge is those that are coming, you know, growing up now may not realize that.
I think you're right.
May not realize that. And I think a lot of the protections that we have as conservationists is because we realize that was a birthright. You can't take, we knew that. Somehow innately we have this. And I see that as one of our challenges is to get out and educate people, in which, Randy, you have done, you know, an unbelievable job on that is our heritage. This is our birthright.
Yeah.
You know, I've listened to you a number of times and you so eloquently talk about, you know, what, you know, public lands made you a conservationist, public lands made you a hunter.
Right.
And when without public lands makes bird watchers, public lands makes conservationists.
Right.
So, you know, flipping it back into the wild sheep mode, about 80% of all wild sheep live on public land.
Really?
Yeah.
80%.
Yeah. So, you know, that obviously public land is a very hot button of the Wild Sheep Foundation.
Yeah.
Keeping it public.
Yeah. Well,
and that's where our resource resides.
Yeah. And it is for me. And people often challenge me that, well, Randy, if you couldn't go and hunt on public lands, you wouldn't give a damn about it. And that gets me pretty wound up. I feel as strongly about those public lands as I do hunting, because both of you have heard my story about how I was able to become a hunter at a very critical point in my life. That, you know, I'm 11 years old, my parents get divorced, my dad moves out of state for a year or so, and I'm like, yeah, you're kind of destroyed because your family is now melted away. But I grew up in a hunting community. Every young person, your goal was, I want to be a hunter or an angler, or a trapper, sure, whatever it was. Sure. And it was so much a part of our culture, of who we are, who our identity was, that all of a sudden I'm like, oh man, how am I going to get to go hunting now? And as you heard me say, fortunately, right out my back door were hundreds of thousands of acres of public land.
Right.
Where even this snotty-nosed 12-year-old, 11-year-old kid could go and sell a few muskrat pelts, buy some 410 shells, walk down to those public lands and shoot a limited grouse and bring them home. And my mom was excited to have them. There was no greater feeling to me than the first time I walked in our little porch attached to our trailer house. And I'm standing there holding these two rough grouse that I shot with my 410. Mm. And my mom was excited because that was dinner for you us. That, we were going to eat that.
You bet.
And throughout the rest of my life, public lands were the place I learned about the natural world. It was the place that connected me to conservation. And I tell people, my story is not unique in America, but the American story and opportunity is unique to the world, because there's young people all over the place that probably went down a similar path where they were able to stay connected to the natural world regardless of what circumstances came into their life because they had public lands. Mm-hmm. And those people go on to be passionate about conservation, whether they hunt or fish or don't hunt, don't fish, don't whatever. The fact that they have a place to go and interact with the natural world, mm-hmm, makes them concerned about the natural world, or at least that's my theory.
I think you're absolutely right. My folks got divorced when I was 5, but neither were hunters. Thank God my mom had the vision, I guess. She was you know, a teller at a bank, single parent household with my sister and myself. She was at a bank picnic on public land and watched some folks fishing. She's thinking about her 7-year-old son and, you know, thinking that's probably a good thing for Gray to do. So that night we went to Gemco, I think it was at the time, and she bought a couple of spinning outfits. And she says, you know, son, I think you should take up fishing. You know, and I'd gone to trout ponds and the like with my dad, but that's how I got involved. And then it's, you know, just a progression. But I wasn't, you know, I didn't grow up in a hunting family. I wasn't born a hunter, but I do believe that I truly was.
Yeah.
You know, it was innate. It was in me. But so my story is the same, Randy. You know, here's a single mom. And then, you know, getting what Shane's going to be talking tonight on his Wild Harvest Initiative. You know, I was proud to bring a few bluegill home.
Yeah.
And we'd fry up bluegill.
Right.
But I was providing for my family. Right. I'd ride on my bicycle and go to Foothills Park, catch some bluegill, catch some catfish, and bring them home.
Yeah.
You know, and mom said, you clean them. But
whether it's bluegills, whether it's rough grouse, Shane, I've heard you talk about in times past, and I can't explain it. Hopefully you can, but there is something in the human electrical circuitry that when you go and acquire your own meal, mm, and you have the blood on your hands, when you've worked for it, you've tried, you've failed, and finally succeeded, and you look down at what's on that plate or what's in that skillet, there is something there that gives me a feeling, an accomplishment, a satisfaction, but also a responsibility that I've yet to find anything else in my life that moves me to that feeling of what I get by acquiring my own food from the landscape.
Well, I think it's really, I don't think it's that difficult to understand. I think any time that human beings re-enter the natural world as completely as we can, we have this experience that transcends any kind of other engagement we have in society. When you look down at a piece of meat in a pan, as you're talking about, you know, you are urgently aware of the cycle of life.
Yeah.
After all, you took it, didn't you?
Right.
So, you know, it has been always my belief that anybody who has ever killed a wild creature has a debt to wildlife that far exceeds anyone who hasn't done that. Mm-hmm. I think this idea of possessing them, pursuing them, which is what made us human, of course. Our various beginnings, we were hunter-gatherers for 99.9% of our existence. agriculture is 10,000 years old, which is virtually nothing.
Right.
And we have this kind of return to self that occurs in hunting, which is critically important in terms of incentivizing us to want to do it again and also to want to be able to relive those experiences and see those animals. It's reflected in many, many aspects of hunting. It's not just the sense that people have of suddenly losing themselves in a world where problems disappear and so on. And it's that's totally understandable because when one hunts, one becomes what Ortega said, which is the alert man. You know, everything that is around you matters more. If you're simply hiking, the direction and speed of wind is something you may acknowledge, but it's not going to make any difference to your hike. but, you know, if you're pursuing a wild creature whose senses are 100 times better and more refined than your own, you know, that's really critical. Again, if you're hiking and you see a track with a certain with water pooling in it, you know, there's been rain, you may see it, but you're not as concerned about how long did that animal pass. All of those things create a unique experience through hunting. The meat that comes from it, the harvest that comes from it, not only does it remind us of all of that, but we also return to our original personas as hunters when we acquire that meat, in that we are driven to share. And I have said this many, many, many times. We take it for granted as hunters and anglers, but this immediate desire to share, to feel proud, but also to share in the consumption of this harvest is an extraordinary thing. You know, and I've said this in many discussions, you know, it occurred to me a long time ago, you know, none of us would go and buy something at a grocery store and give it to our uncle or our grandmother or our brother or our sister
or our neighbor.
And if we did, they would think we were insane, you know. But I mean, the first thing we do when we have this wild meat is we want to share it. And of course, this goes right back to the beginnings. I mean, in our hunter-gatherer societies, only a small percentage of the people were actually the ones who hunted. It's not, you know, it wasn't that everybody did it and that everybody was good at it.
Right.
Some were far better than others, just as today.
Right.
But everyone shared in that meat. And in the sharing, the communities thrived. The children were born. They were raised successfully. They were raised healthy. They went on to become adults. So this capturing of our essence of who we are deep inside ourselves, there's probably no other experience that lifts it up to the extent that hunting can. We have some proxies, such as athletics and other things, which borrow some of those things.
Yeah.
The hand-eye coordination, the agility, the capacity to strategize and think ahead and all these things. But nothing immerses us. And how could it? This was our natural function, our natural performance.
Yeah.
We were an actor on that stage, no different than the sheep, no different than the great bear, no different than the coyote and the bobcat and the lynx and the mountain lion. We were exactly the same. So how could it not be? I mean, just imagine in our own personal lives, our memories of who we were as children, the places that mattered to us.
Yeah.
And how returning to them can be such a powerful emotive experience. Well, this is something we do in the hunt, except it extends back to the very beginning of our species and of our time on this planet. And so naturally, when we go there, we're overwhelmed with this sense that somehow this is right, somehow this is where we belong. Now, have we done a good job as hunters in communicating that? No.
No, we have not.
Does every hunter feel it to the same extent? No, they do not.
Right.
But regardless of that, those statistics don't change the fact that this is a reality for millions of people, and has been, was 50 years ago, and was 100 years ago, and was 150 and 200 years ago, and so on. And not just in our countries, but in other parts of the world. So I think what the harvest is, what the meat is, just as, you know, the pelage and the horns and other things, it is a physical reminder of what we have gone through, that we have taken a life, and we will respect that life by strengthening ourselves, both physically and, I think, philosophically, in terms of wanting to keep those animals with us. And think about the people who receive that meat, even non-hunters. Mm-hmm. We all have non-hunters that we share our meat with.
Yeah.
Think about how delighted they are. I mean,
they are.
Whoever says that a fresh brook trout is a bad gift, or a moose roast is a bad gift. I mean, I've never met such a person.
Yeah,
right. I bet you haven't either.
No.
So these are the special things around hunting, and about what wildlife gives us, because only they can give this to us.
Right.
Right. Only they can do that. We can't create plastic models that do that. There's no replacement for them.
No.
And so this is why, you know, I have said, you know, I always question, you know, do we honor the hunted enough?
Yeah, I question that also. And maybe it's an age thing, but I was reflecting on a TV episode we filmed last week about, now that I'm going to be 52 here in a little more than a month, how my hunting is so much more about just being connected to this natural place that is, I now see it as so important to me, so integral to who I am, that even if I was out there without a tag in my pocket, I'd still have a really good time. I like having a tag in my pocket because it does take me, I guess, even deeper into the experience.
Yeah, you bet.
It's back to the point of...
You bet. Your senses are alert.
Right. Yeah. I hike all summer to stay in shape, but I do not get the same response internally. The mechanisms do not fire internally when I'm hiking to stay in shape, as they do when I'm walking around with a sharp stick on a string trying to get within 20 yards mm-hmm. of a fully alert elk.
You bet.
And even though I know my odds are really, really slim that I'm I'm going to have any meat to share, there is just something about that. And I don't know. I wish I had an easy way to convey that. But it's such a powerful and deep feeling and connection. I struggle as hard as I try, and I spend a lot of time trying to vocalize it, trying to articulate it, and I still don't feel I'm doing it justice.
Well, I don't think you're alone in that, and I don't think we at this time in human history are alone in it. You know, I've many times remarked upon the incredible power and beauty of the parietal art, the cave art that exists in, particularly in Europe, mm-hmm. in France and Spain in particular, but other parts of the world too. You know, some of those areas, some of those caves were painted over periods of time of 20 to 30,000 years. So we are in our present form about 50,000 years old as modern humans. And for a huge percentage of that time, you know, we took the opportunity to go into these deep, dark caverns and paint these species on the wall in just absolutely glorious color and movement and so forth. And, you know, you ask yourself the question, I mean, scholars have pondered it forever. I mean, why? Why did these people do this? Why did they do it for so long? Why are the only images that are painted in fulsome color and detail, right down to their pelage in some cases, why is it just animals? You know, why are all the human figures just little stick people? Mm-hmm. Right? I mean,
but yet the animals are
in full perfect glory. Yeah. So obviously, these people too were striving to, I think, communicate exactly some of the things that you are talking about. You know, nobody goes, as I've said many times, deep into a cave, in some cases scaling internal cliffs, swimming rivers, running through those caves in some cases, going into deep recesses with a tiny little bit of light, you know, provided by a animal fat burning in a hollowed out stone or a seashell, and paints these glorious things and does this repeatedly over periods of time, not continuously, but groups of humans did it over 20 and 30,000 years.
Incredible.
You don't do that unless you go there to honor those animals and to give expression to your, some kind of deep feeling. They obviously weren't writing it in books at the time, of course.
Yeah.
It hadn't been invented.
Yeah.
But they were doing art, unbelievable visual art, that long ago, I think, trying to convey these same things. And it speaks to us even today.
Yeah, and I guess that's where I struggle is knowing that we live in this society that is becoming very disconnected. If, and maybe I overuse that term, but how do we convey those feelings? How do we get people to understand how important this is? When it's almost like our society says, well, we can replicate or package any experience, and it's as good as the native experience, the actual reality of a natural experience. And I don't know how we address that in this society. And that's a big part of what I spend my time challenging myself to do is, all right, Randy, you know this feeling, you know how it connects you to the natural world. How do you convince your viewers, your listeners, or others who don't even listen to you? How do you provide leadership to a society that's going this direction of more urbanized, less connected, consuming an artificial experience of what the natural world is? How do you bring them? How do you give this message of importance of conservation to them? I think we as hunters can lead in that, but I wonder if we are leading society at times. If we're circling the wagon, are we leaders? I think we're leaders because of what we do. We're investing money, we're doing the volunteering, we're making a difference on the landscape. But there's like this bigger tide out there that is, well, there, I don't know what you want to call it, but just a growing, you know, population and a higher demand on resources. How do we as leaders bring those people along and say, this works, this is how we do it, this is what we do?
You know, we're all facing that challenge, but we also know some ways not to do it. And and sadly, you know, to throw the skunk on the table, you know, social media is you know, our boon and our you know, yeah, our bane.
Right.
I got into this industry professionally, building chapters of Safari Club International.
Okay.
You know, back in the early 90s, and we built those organizations to create the nest. It was a group of men and women that could sit around a table or have a beverage and talk about hunting stories and share their hunting stories. And it was something that often they couldn't do at the bank or the CPA office or, mm-hmm, or you know, wherever they were working at the, and now, you know, I look, and this gets back to that. We think we can, you know, we think we can share a hunting experience through a video game.
Yeah.
Or a Facebook post, or an Instagram post. And then force feed what we're doing onto a populace that doesn't understand it.
Right.
And then we wonder why they get upset. And we wonder why, you know, regardless of the legalities or like of the Cecil the Lion or, you know, a controversy over a, you know, a young gal who's hunted a giraffe. And we want to, you know, we wonder, you know, and then we almost take a front to it.
Right.
Well, no, you need to accept what I do. But here, you know, here we are sitting around. We're three hunters. We're sitting around a table in a room with that celebrates hunting, celebrates conservation, and we have a difficult time expressing to each other why we hunt.
Yeah.
But then we think we can instantly convey that to someone that hasn't experienced it through an instant message or a photo and wonder why. So, you know,
no,
I know why we should, you know, what we're doing wrong. I'm not quite sure I know how to fix it, you know.
It's funny you say that, Gray, because on the podcast that people listened to just before this one, I went on a tirade about how I want to blow up my Facebook page. And in that tirade, I said hunting was not ready for social media. We haven't yet figured out how to craft a message that conveys the power of our experiences. How long has print been around? Hundreds and hundreds of years.
Right.
And we've struggled to convey it in print.
Right.
How do we think we're going to convey it in video or in instant messaging kind of things that we do today? And I think that's a huge danger for us, the way we go about it.
I'm not so sure I agree with you, Randy, that we fail to convey it in print. I think we were doing a pretty good job of conveying it, frankly, up until about the 1960s or so.
Okay.
And even today, I think there are some very good publications that still keep the tradition of writing about this in a deep way alive.
Yeah.
The attachment that people have, for example, you know, to their hunting dogs and their experiences, the love they have for those animals, as well as the experiences of field. I mean, the people look at Roosevelt himself, the dozens of books that he wrote where he conveyed feelings that matter to a great many people, not all of them who hunted. I think we were doing a pretty good job. I do think that social media has been a factor in the mix that has led us away from that. But I also think that, you know, we began in the 60s and 70s to experiment with a lot of things, television, closer ties between industry and hunting. You know, there were patterns that emerged, and we certainly began to do things differently. If you look back on the arc of writing alone in this genre, and not just in this country, but reading translations of European journals and so on, it's very much the same. You know, the writings of people like even O'Connor and people of that sort of group, it was clear that there were two things that they really cared about and really honored. And one was the animal itself, and the other was the experience. In our attempts, perhaps, to personalize hunting in some ways, the shift certainly came on the hunter. The emphasis became, after the 60s and 70s and on until today, the emphasis came on the hunter. And that emphasis was given, I mean, a completely new life when social media was born.
Yeah, so now everybody has a platform.
Yeah, so I don't blame and I don't accept the arguments that a lot of people propose, you know, that social media is the cause of X and Y relative to the public impression of hunting. I think we were the ones who took that medium, as we took print, as we took television, as we take radio, as we now take podcast, as we do these things. We take a medium and we use it.
Right.
But I think the real shift became the emphasis on the hunter. And once that became the emphasis, I think this also began to raise in the public mind a lot of questions about this. Because it laid out the question, what really is your motivation?
Right.
What really is your motivation? And I can tell you, as somebody who spends a lot of time working internationally now, there is a rising empathy for wild animals everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And
for sure,
we need to recognize that why we do what we do is going to be increasingly questioned. And what most people will care about is, are we doing things that help wildlife? Are we putting sheep on the mountain? You know, are we doing something? Because if we're not doing that, then the rest of our feelings that you wish to convey, you know, how deeply it affects right. you emotionally, physically, psychologically, neurologically, all of which is true, and there's lots of research to demonstrate this, that's not going to so much matter to the people who will never do it. And right now, we have 95.3% of the American population who don't do it.
Think about that, people. Yeah. 95.3% of your community, this country, do not have a perspective by which to judge what right. we are putting out there.
Yeah. So the only perspective they're going to develop, obviously, because the only one they can, is the messaging that we relate to them, that we give to them.
Right.
And so, you know, I think we had a pretty good track record. And some of those people who wrote in that way, and some still do, inspired a lot of people. Yep. You know,
you bet.
Read them in bed, you know, with the lamp on, right? You know, and stayed up late. And but it was all about, you know, I don't think we were thinking about the taking of the life. I think we were thinking about, boy, I want to be out there. I want to see all that. I want to experience that. You know, I want my tent to be rained out, and I want to, you know, be a struggle. I mean, and this was what the writing was about. And, you know, they'd celebrate the animal that escaped. My God, you know, we thought for sure, but no way that animal got wind of us. How did he do it? You know, the wind was in our favor. You know, there should have been no way that an animal. How did he see us at that distance? You know, this was the stuff that would peppered their writings. We largely replaced that, right?
Yeah.
We've largely replaced that. Look at the vast majority of our television efforts.
Right.
We've largely replaced that.
Yeah.
And the same way in our writing, our magazines and so on. Look at some of the imagery that, you know, we're putting out. I mean, we have to question ourselves with respect to this.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, right now, as we know, there's a real desire to change the narrative somewhat, to convey the real essence of hunting to people and to develop new messages, whether we use social media to convey it or standard media to convey right. it. You know, the hunting community realizes this, I think. But, you know, we have to ask ourselves, are we going to try and do that and still have all those other perhaps negative messages still resonating?
Right.
And just, you know, add a dollop of cream, you know, and affect to change people? Because right. what we do know, you know, I've just been in Bozeman for a few days visiting with Gray and the Sheep Foundation. You know, walk into any store in this town, and just in any one store, and enumerate the number of animal images that you see.
Right.
On greeting cards, on cushions, on furniture, on clothing, on lighting, on anything. You know, we are obsessed with them in one way or another. And we'll either learn to be obsessed with them, but not find practical ways to keep them, or we will find ways to be obsessed with them and also find practical ways. Conservation is a practical business. And one of the things I think the hunting and angling communities have demonstrated by efforts for over 100 years is that we can design an incredible array of practical ways of helping them, from taxation things to forming non-governmental organizations that take up a particular cause, like wild sheep, for example, or elk or ducks or whatever, you know, by producing beautiful films. And, you know, we have within us the capacity, I think, to reach the general public with regard to this thing called hunting. But it's not going to happen unless we try and align that message with the empathies that the general public have towards these wild creatures. We can't stand apart from them. We have to be part of that community.
Yeah. Listening to you talk there, Shane, I was writing down some notes because you talked about, okay, are we just going to dabble in the idea that, okay, this is our messaging, and we're going to let the negative messages continue to proliferate and be out there. But I'm trying to put myself in the shoes of someone in that 90-some percent and say, all right, here's what I see from that hunting world. Most of what I see is something I probably don't really relate to. I've not been involved in this for my lifetime, so I really can't understand the benefit or the value that someone has of five guys sitting around a dead animal smiling and taking a picture of it, and there's blood on its nose and its tongue is hanging out and blah, blah, blah. But yet these 5% who are hunters are trying to tell me they're serious about conservation. I struggle does the way we communicate our story and our motives, because what they see is what that group sees as our images is what they use to determine our motives. I believe.
Yeah. We give them the story.
Right. And if we give them images and story that conveys in their mind a motive different than what we either have truly or falsely, maybe some people have a different motive for it. These people aren't dumb. They're going to draw from those images what they think our motive is. And then we get up and say, oh, we're conservationists. We're the wild sheep people. We're here for elk. We're here for turkeys or ducks or wild salmon, whatever it might be. I wonder if this imagery problem or this messaging story problem makes it harder to convince greater society that we could and should be leaders in the world of conservation.
I don't think there's any doubt. You're posing it as a question, Randy, but I think the answer is also in your head. I mean,
right.
I don't think there's any doubt that we have hurt ourselves.
Yeah, you're right. I kind of say it rhetorically, but it's more of a comment than a question of how is it realistic for us to expect greater society to think we are serious about conservation when our imagery to them is not that.
You bet. Yeah, we got to walk the talk. Yeah, just sitting here listening to you, Randy, and you, Shane, and I was thinking of the messaging that our organization puts out, and I'm 55, so I'm no social media genius, but it's really interesting to look at our Facebook page. And again, I don't know, okay, there was, you reached so and so, 70,000 people or 23,000 people. I don't quite understand exactly what that means, and really if that is a true image. But it's interesting to me when we talk or say or even make some comment on our social media platform that we think is meaningful, that talks conservation, we're getting a tenth, maybe if we're doing well, a fifth of the reach that when we put just a beautiful picture of a bighorn or a stone sheep, sure, or a doll sheep. But then oddly enough, if you put a dead one on there too, you get about the same reaction. So I don't know what the answer is.
But it's a real interesting deal.
I could just look at our page and go, okay, we got this message out on a water project that we just developed and 10,000 people see it.
Yeah,
we put a beautiful picture of a sheep out there, dead or alive, admittedly, and 70,000, 80,000, 60 shares. I mean, it's the imagery is real. Well, you know. But how the heck do we capture that? How do we link the essence of hunting to those images? You know, Shane, you talked, you know, we walk around Bozeman and, you know, we see the wildlife and you know, and it's, I'll tell you, it's such a privilege to share this area with you and Kim. And Randy, you know, we floated the Yellowstone and I talked to my shuttle guy and he goes, you know, it's muddy. We've been having rain and you know, I hear the fishing's pretty poor. And I said, you know what? It's going to be a beautiful day. I've got two wonderful friends from Newfoundland here and we're really not that mad at the fish. And so, yeah, the river was muddy. We had a glorious day. And what's so exciting is to see the passion that Shane has and that Kim has for wildlife. And I'm, you know, as I'm rowing the boat, I'm thinking, you know, how do we get that message across? You know, how do we have it, but you know, where there's that 95% out there, the 95%+, and we've got to figure out how do we, you know, we can do it one-on-one. You know, we can do it one-on-one. I mean, you take young hunters, Randy, hunting. Mm-hmm. I've got a cousin that lives in California, and he contacted me several years back, and he says, you know, my son, Connor, is taking an interest in firearms. Don't know how and why, but he's got an interest in it, and I know nothing about him. Can you help? You bet. I said, come out. I was living in Cody at the time. They came out, gave him some training, spent time with him. I hadn't seen my cousin in 15 years. Mm-hmm. Long and short of it, I thought, you know, Connor's going to become a hunter. And within a few months, he's interested in hunting. Got him through hunter safety, took him on his first hunt. His dad was with him as a non-hunter. I hope I shared my, you know, my experience. I hope I shared my ethics. I hope I shared my passion for the resource. And lo and behold, three hunts later, his sister now wants to hunt. You know, and she had told me, there's no way. Well, no, we took her on a pronghorn hunt. And she took her pronghorn. Shane and I were visiting on this because I was saying, you know, how do we reach people? And it is often a one-on-one, but it all then tied back to this food and providing. And Connor, when he took his white-tailed deer, what was so important to that 17-year-old boy is that he was going to provide meat to his family. Yeah. And there was, you know, there was, I thought, okay, you know, there's a message there. But then I heard back from my cousin, who they had not eaten wild game. He said, you know, we had Connor prepared some white-tailed deer for us for Thanksgiving. And, you know, that boy was proud. And his family were proud. And you had two Southern California folks. Connor's mother is a surfer. You know, she says, hey, I'm a surfer gal. I have absolutely no understanding of this hunter thing, other than the fact that my son wants to do it, and so I want him to learn how to do it right. So I don't know. I think we can reach that non-hunter. We've got to do it correctly.
Yeah, I mean, I think we have to keep perspective on this too, and realize that it, being the tiny minority we are. We have an amazing statistic that, you know, 78% to 80% of the public in the United States still supports, you know, legal, regulated, you know, hunting.
Right.
So while, you know, our messaging is critical and it's facing new challenges, we need to realize that up till this point in time, somehow or other, you know, we've done a reasonably good job, or else the public support would not be there. I think the real question for us is, are we paying enough attention to the real changes that are taking place in society? And are we prepared to change our messages to reflect that? I mean, even if Theodore Roosevelt was here today, you know, some of the points of emphasis he would make would not necessarily resonate with the modern society. Some of them clearly would, but not necessarily all of them. So we have a very a creeping problem, which is that more and more people are being separated from nature, and more importantly, I guess, they're being separated from the ecology of the planet. So they don't see the cycle of life. They don't see a calf, even a domestic animal, being born. They don't see it flooding into the world in a mixture of water and blood, and they don't see it suckling from its mother. They don't see it grow and mature and play and then learn to become an adult animal and then be killed and butchered to feed people. They don't see any of this anymore. Mm-hmm. So we have to ask ourselves the question, how are we going to keep the truth about these activities of hunting and angling, but deliver them in a way that matters to a mind, a collective mind in our countries, that has changed fundamentally in some ways from what it was 40, 50 years ago. I think to some extent we have evidence in one of our cherished programs to indicate that no matter how much passion we have and no matter how hard we try, we can end up not having the success we want if our messages are out of sync with modern society. And, you know, I was part of some of the very early hunter retention and recruitment programs in this country and in Canada. And these were born of real concern, genuine. People tried their very best to come up with all kinds of good ideas. Money was found. Huge amounts of energy and intellect and time were put into these programs. But I think a fair assessment is now shared by a lot of people that, you know, the programs haven't created the kind of momentum that we had hoped. So, you know, we need to study these kinds of things and need to learn from them. So why didn't that happen? I think part of the reason why it didn't happen is because many of our programs were out of sync with the modern realities of society. We wanted to create hunter retention and recruitment programs that mirrored our childhoods. We wanted to recreate the opportunity of, you know, Uncle Jack brought me, or my dad brought me, or my granddad brought me. And so we got youth seasons, get them early, you know, and we take one, make one, you know.
Right.
Let's take a child with, or a young person hunting and so on. But of course, you can't replace that constant kind of engagement with just one time or a two time, and no one can always take another child hunting and things right. of this nature. And so we should learn from these things and ask ourselves why, especially when at exactly the same time, without any real dedicated effort on our part at all, we suddenly see recruitment coming into the hunting community from completely different sources.
Right.
Young women, you know, between the ages of 25 and 40 are coming in. And, you know, young men are joining from where? Not from rural America and rural Newfoundland or rural Canada. they're rising in our cities.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why? Because some of them are developing a sensibility about being responsible for their food.
Right.
So they've developed this ecological conscience, which is completely different than the one we learned by trial and error and actual experience, raising chickens and periodically having to kill them to eat them and, you know, and hunting and fishing and so on. They've come to it completely differently. So we have to really ask ourselves, let's not try to recreate the world as we would like it. Let's try to speak to the world as it really is.
Yeah. No, I couldn't agree more, Shane. In its most simplified terms, in the business world, excuse me, the old saying is, you don't sell what you want to sell; you sell what your customer wants to buy.
You know? Bet.
Wait. Yeah. And I know that's an oversimplification of what you just said there, but I
No.
I think it's completely correct. If we want people to be tied to this natural world, we want them to become conservationists, we better do it in a way that resonates with them, not what resonates with us.
You know, it's funny. Shane, remember the governor's symposiums? I think you and I met at one in Houston, I think it was. Yeah, and, you know, we had these symposiums. I'll never forget, and it kind of ties back to how we're really messaging or how we really feel, the whole symposium was on recruitment and retention, and we had some experts that were going to tell us that we need to start doing a soup to nuts kind of a from hunter safety to the end product, like a scuba shop at a Bass Pro or a Cabela's or a Shields or a Sportsman's Warehouse or whatever. And we go through all these ramifications and all this mashing and coming up with these great ideas that, Shane, you've just spoken on. And I can remember Raleigh Sparrow getting up on the stage. He was with WMI back then. He gets up on the stage and he says, "How many mule deer hunters do we have in this room?" You know, a bunch of arms go up. And all right. Those of you who are mule deer hunters, how many of you, we just talked about hunter recruitment and retention, how many of you want more mule deer hunters in the field when you're mule deer hunting?
Yeah.
And so there's a fundamental challenge that we have.
Right.
The hunting experience is for the most part a solo or a loner or small groups experience. We're not going to go into a stadium and watch a football game. Mm-hmm. We want to be alone, or we want to be, and we want to be at one, obviously, with the game. But there's a fundamental problem there. Even from the get-go, that's the messaging. We're talking about a message that, we want more hunters. Well, do we? According to Raleigh Sparrow and that governor's symposium in Houston back in the 90s, no.
But we are.
No. But we need them from a funding standpoint.
Well,
we sure as heck need them.
And we are going to face a significant loss of hunters very mm-hmm. soon.
We are.
That's unavoidable. And what we need to be thinking about is, as the aging group of hunters dies or simply leaves hunting because, they're not fit enough or not
infirmity.
Able to do it anymore, how do we keep hunting through that period and then begin the process of hopefully recruiting more people? What's very clear is that the people that are going to join hunting on this other end of this loss of older hunters are not going to be exactly the same people who were part of that big group that we're losing.
You bet. Right.
And so we need to be thinking about how do we represent hunting in a way that will still bring people to it with all the challenges we have of urbanization and distance from nature and all these kinds of things. But when we see people, wanting to have more organic food, wanting to live more healthy lifestyles, wanting to be a sensible part of a sustainable world, we can see a prospect. We can see a vision for the way we need to position this. And, Gray has made the point about, the impact that the image of an animal can have. And, this is part of this innate, fascination with them. As I've said many times, give me 50 children of 50 different races and 50 different languages, at 5 years of age that I've never met, put them in a room, give them the best toys that have ever been invented, leave them alone for 45 minutes, and bring in a frog and put it on this table here, and I guarantee you every one of them will turn to it. So, there's just no doubt about this. So, if we think about those kinds of things, then that leads to the question, how are these people that might come to hunting, they have to believe in something more than hunting. They also have to believe in hunters. right? They have to look at hunters and say, you know, they're good people. They do good things for wildlife. They have to get that message.
Right.
And, you know, I have long espoused, you know, hunting organizations and hunters as individuals speaking out about issues that don't pertain to hunting but pertain to wildlife.
Boy.
You know?
Yeah.
And Gray mentions it, groups, you know, individuals from PETA, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, you know, coming to his meeting here. Well, the truth of the matter is we do share. We share. It's not just what they share with us, but it's what we share with them. We do share concerns, and we should share concerns about ethical treatment of animals.
Yep.
I think hunting communities should always have been speaking out about animal welfare issues, for example.
Yep.
And I also think that, you know, one of the things I try to suggest to a lot of organizations is set a percentage of the money that you bring in as a hunting organization, 20%, something significant, and make sure you invest it in things that have nothing to do with hunted species. You know, why aren't we supporting sea turtle recovery efforts? Mm-hmm. You know, why aren't we, you know, investing sometimes in, I don't know, you know, black-footed ferret restoration? I mean, we thought that animal was extinct on the North American continent until it was found in one ranch.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, these are monarch butterflies. We know the emotive appeal this has. And I think for people to see us doing that is one of the ways that we create a group of people. Because the people who will come to hunting in the future, I don't believe that they are going to carry necessarily exactly the same motivations we have.
Nope.
But they will carry a concern for nature.
Yeah.
And I think we have to be the ones who help them to understand. I don't want to sound condescending to a future people, but to help them somehow understand, or we must represent the understanding that death of animals is inevitable. Whether it's commercial fisheries or the livestock industry, we know that 7.2 on our way to 8 and 9, animal death is an absolute inevitability.
Right.
You may be uncomfortable with the death of a moose, but you're going to have to get used to the eating of fish. I mean, you know, we're all going to have to make those judgments.
Yeah.
But animal death is inevitable. I think the real question for us is, how do we anticipate what these new people in a new society, the young people coming up, how do we anticipate the things that will inspire them to not just become, in quotation mark, hunters, you know, a number,
right,
but to become conservationists who understand that sustainable use of wildlife has a 100-year proven track record of extraordinary success. And if you love animals, you don't throw out something that works. You just don't do it.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting that you say that, Shane. My YouTube channel is, we just launched it in January. And this morning when I woke up, we're at 2 million views on our YouTube channel already since we started. And I look at the demographic profile of that. And as you can imagine, the bell curve gets pretty steep in they break it out from 25 to 34. It's really steep there, and then it plateaus, and then when it gets out there later, it starts dropping down. But 82% of the viewers are from 25 to 65.
Huh.
And I look at the episodes and the content that is not, I mean, all of our old TV episodes are out there, and we're putting them up there, and, you know, and there's some of that traditional, you know, shoot, take pictures, everyone celebrates, blah, blah, blah. But the amount of positive comment I get on episodes where we didn't kill anything, we didn't fill a tag, we had a very interesting experience of weather, of conditions, or the elk or the deer just outsmarted us or whatever. This younger audience that is there on YouTube is attracted to that.
Mm-hmm.
That more so than the traditional TV audience. When I look at my TV ratings of episodes, those are more, okay, we shot a really big elk and that one got a lot of
right.
viewership. It's not necessarily that way in this younger YouTube audience that I'm kind of have as my, I guess, group of guinea pigs, if you want to call them that. So I think there's a huge opportunity to reach those people and give messaging that appeals to them. And if there is a beauty to the whole digital internet world, is there's a democracy to it where they're going to decide Absolutely. What they want to consume instead of these hubs, these kind of constricting funnels of networks or other groups deciding what they're going to get to consume.
Well, it's much more like books, isn't it?
Yeah,
it is. You decide to pick it up or not pick it up. I mean, I think this is another piece of evidence to go back to the point I made earlier, that the writing of years ago that attracted the generation of hunters that we, let's say, are part of, that emphasized exactly what you're saying is in those particular episodes that appeals to people. They want this. They're not that interested in seeing the dead animal. They're not that interested in the grip and grin. What they're interested in is the experience and the fact that you were foiled, you know, by this creature. Well, I mean, that's exactly the message of Jack O'Connor.
Shane, those were adventure stories.
Totally.
Right.
It's the adventure.
Yeah, totally.
You know, you talked about putting a frog on a table with, you know, 50 kids.
Yeah.
There isn't a kid that's not interested in some form of adventure.
Absolutely true.
Whether it's building a fort, a treehouse, going on a hike, and that hike may. I think it all falls into this. Yeah. It's the adventure and those stories. You know, you read Jack O'Connor. You know, if you're into Africa, you're reading Rourke. You know, or you're reading Hemingway or what did they speak of? Adventure.
Yeah.
What do we now speak of? Success and failure.
Exactly.
I was successful. What does that mean?
Well, I'm plowing good ground on that so far this year. I've been on two hunts, and I don't have a punch tag yet. And,
yeah, so you know what? Your YouTube channel's going to blow through the ceiling.
Keep failing, man.
Yeah.
Keep failing.
But you know what's going to be interesting when I get my TV ratings for this season that's airing right now is 40% of our episodes we failed. That's the most ever. And when I first started this, I put some episodes out there where we didn't fill tags.
Right.
And the industry, kind of the old guard is like, oh, no one's going to watch that. Well, people watched it and they commented, oh yeah, that happens to me.
Been there, done that.
Yeah. Or man, that was so cool to see that animal standing there. And it just didn't come together. It showed more of this interaction of human prey that's been going on forever, and they were able to see it in a way that most other shows didn't. So I started getting more comfortable where, 20 or 30% of our episodes each year would then not have the end result. It was all journey. There really was no destination.
No money shot.
And those have been some of our best viewed episodes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think there's a, I think we have to be careful too that in trying to solve our problems, we don't become, we don't make the same mistake that I think in some ways has gotten us here, which is to treat society or to treat hunters or to treat anti-hunters or non-hunters as monoliths.
Right.
I mean, within the hunting community, there are people for whom, the end result is more important than to some others. I think what happened, going back to this marriage between industry and the hunting community in the 60s and 70s, which I referred to, is that idea of success and that idea of animal death was considered to be the formula necessary for success and viewership. We all know this. This is no secret. It's not a slamming of anybody. I mean, that's just an absolute reality. I remember having people say, well, not only do we need one kill shot in a show, we'll get better ratings if we have two. And I mean, these were real conversations that took place. So I think what's almost certainly happening, Randy, is that, there was always a group of hunters out there, a group of viewers, if you will, who were not necessarily fixated on that recipe.
Yeah.
And we were missing them. And I think now we're finding them. And of course, you look at the fact that there's 14.5 million hunters in the United States of America. And you ask yourself, look at the viewership of the vast majority of shows and ask yourself what percentage of this, you know, this club, this entity called the hunting world is actually viewing them. I mean, right. It might have been a statistic that somebody might have looked at, you know, over the years and said, you know right. what, we're probably missing a lot of people for some reason. I mean, I don't know that we will ever get to the point where, from a hunting viewership point of view, you know, that it won't still be important or relevant that there will be circumstances where an animal dies.
Right. Oh, yeah.
But we do need to realize that even as we try to reach this wider society, the non-hunting public, this 95% that's out there, I think, you know, one of the things we need to recognize is we also need to reach the full community of hunters with our messaging. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we have been doing that very effectively. And so that says to me,
agreed.
Look, there's 14.5 million people who already have made an investment in wildlife in some way, accidentally or otherwise, by buying things, by doing things, by traveling, and so on and so forth. What if we could really motivate all of them? Mm-hmm. What if we really had an army of 14.5 million? What about the 35 to 40 million people in Canada and the United States who hunt and fish? What about we could get every single one of them motivated? What about we could even convince every single one of them to give $5 a year to some kind of conservation fund?
That would be huge.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm just raising these points out of consideration that as we attempt to be inclusive and reach out to a much wider public, which obviously we need to do, I think we also need to re-examine just how we've been reaching out to this community that we already have. And we develop formulae. You know, our magazine should be like this, or our television show should be like that, or whatever it might be. But, you know, how do we know that just because we have success, that we haven't left a huge amount of greater success on the table? Not explored, not developed.
Well, Shane, let me give you a real poignant example. You know, we talked about the conservation community, the hunter conservationists, you know, and Randy, you talked about the different organizations that are out there. So let's look at the different organizations out there. We've got, you know, we got Turkey Federation and Elk Foundation and Mule Deer and, you know, Sheep Foundation, all of these organizations. You tally up the collective membership of those organizations, and I doubt if it is equal to the number of hunters in Pennsylvania and Texas that go into the field each year.
Oh, it's definitely not.
You know? I'm sure. Yeah. You're correct.
I mean, you know, you put a million hunters in the field in Texas, you put a million hunters in the field in Pennsylvania. You know, Michigan's not too far behind.
Yeah.
And when you look at the collective of our membership associations, what does that tell me as the CEO of one of them? Mm-hmm. Maybe we're not doing a very good job. You know, we're not getting them. We're not capturing them. So you're absolutely spot on. You know, with the Sheep Foundations, you know, we've got a very rare species. You know, all the little critter groups, you know, everything that walks, slithers, or crawls, has got some sort of an advocacy organization. You know, we're one of them. And the sheep community is relatively small. And, you know, the Sheep Foundation has a decent piece of that pie. But, you know, we're not reaching them all either. But, you know, going much broader, you know, like a white-tailed deer, and, you know, we're missing a huge component of our own community.
We are, and I think, you know, if I look back and use that, I mean, you know, I look at planning for the future like crossing a stream. Unlike a lot of people, I've had far more experiences close up with wild creatures, not hunting, than I've had hunting. Because my career as a research biologist put me in that circumstance. And so I have years and years, literally, of unbroken time, if you put it all together, of living with animals in Newfoundland that were experienced that had nothing to do with hunting them. And that gives you, I think, a somewhat different perspective in that you really come to know them as individuals, because in many cases you saw the same groups of animals, et cetera, over long periods of time. My point here is that if we look back on the history of hunting and conservation in the United States and in Canada, because the two countries worked in parallel, thankful to Teddy Roosevelt, who had the foresight to invite to his original conference in 1909, 1910, Canada and Newfoundland, which was a separate country at the time. We had a period of real revolution where we had nothing, and we created the movement in the early part of the 20th century, latter part of the 19th. Then suddenly we realized by the 1930s that we couldn't do it through predator control and just forming, you know, some organizations and putting up a few game laws. We had to find big money real fast. We all of a sudden realized that taking all the predators out and so on and so forth would eventually lead to overpopulations and terrible circumstances of starvation in some herds, the kebab and other experiences. And so the whole birthing took place in the 1930s of the Pittman-Robertson funding, the Wallop Road, Dingle Johnson, and so on, that matured after a period of time. The Wildlife Management Institute was founded, the Wildlife Society was founded, all those kinds of things. And that was the second revolution, and Aldo Leopold's knowledge explosion and wildlife management. Well, I think we're in a third revolution now, and a poignant question that's related to this participation by hunters. Every time the first two revolutions we came through demanded new institutions. Mm-hmm. I believe that we will have an experiment running now where some hunting-based organizations are going to adopt this much wider, more inclusive, you know, inviting people for green drinks and so on, as you've talked about, Gray, with the Wild Sheep Foundation. I think some will fail to adapt, and I think they'll wither and die, frankly.
Yeah.
But I think we'll also see the rise of new organizations that will take advantage but not, or appeal to or respond to all of these changes we've been talking about in society. And I don't know exactly what they will look like, but I know that they will start from the very beginning with this wider, more inclusive, you know, identity from the very beginning. It'd be like a Boone and Crockett Club, but there'll be people around that table who will really have very disparate views, who will found that organization from the very inception. And some of them will be hunters and some of them won't be hunters. And their mandate will be different and their investments will be different. And I think this is an experiment that I'm watching very closely because I think this is absolutely inevitable. I think what we can really do, I mean, you take an organization like Wild Sheep, you know, here's an almost impossible task. I mean, just think about that. These animals live in the most inaccessible, in a lot of cases,
right,
in really inaccessible places and all of the challenges. And yet an organization develops to further some earlier work that was done and to set about themselves to try and, you know, recreate these populations all up and down a massive piece of territory and figure out how to do this. Well, that experience of being able to do that is something that this organization, the Wild Sheep Foundation, now has that it, to some extent, probably takes for granted. You know, we did it. This is what we do. This is how we do it. We know how to do it. Maybe one of the things that our hunting organizations need to be doing is reaching out and encouraging even new organizations and saying, you know, to young people in their 20s, you know, this is what you can do, and here's our experience about some of the best ways of doing it. I had a young person call me up earlier this year and talk about some things, and they wanted to volunteer with an organization and so on and so forth. And this was a young woman, you know, probably 19, 20, 21 years of age. And I said to her, I said, why don't you found your own? I said, why don't you found your own? I said, well, how could I do that? I said, look, in today's world, you can produce a blog, you can produce a little newsletter. You probably know more how to do that than I do, that's mm-hmm. for sure. And why don't you just form a little organization in your own community, in your high school or in your university or wherever you want to? I said, I'm not saying that, you know, joining an organization is not a good thing, but, you know, we need also to have people doing what the people did who formed the Wild Sheep Foundation when they came together, or the Elk Foundation when right. they came together, or the Boone and Crockett Club when sure. they came together. And I don't want those organizations to be on one side or the other.
Right.
There's no future for wildlife in that. We're going to have far too many problems, from climate change to industrialization to population explosions to disease. I mean, so many problems facing wildlife that one eventually will be looked back upon as such a ridiculous thing to fight over. It really will be. By the middle of this century, we'll be looking back on that as some kind of just ridiculous, like arcane thing, like like trying to fight for feudal estates or something in Europe. I really believe that that will be true. And so one of the predictions I will make on your show is that we will see the rise of completely novel organizations. Maybe somebody like Mark Zuckerberg, who is now hunted deer, maybe the founder of Facebook will hear this, and maybe he will decide, you know what? I can really do something big for the conservation of wildlife. And maybe he'll step up with this sort of wider view and found something. I mean, I think there's hope in this.
It's interesting you say that, Shane, because, and I wish I would have printed this off when I read it. There's a study out there, and someone hopefully will email it to me because they've read it, about millennials and Gen Xers and others, how they are not membership people.
Mm-hmm.
So we in the conservation world have built these organizations mm-hmm. based on the traditional membership model.
Yeah.
Okay. How do we adapt right. to a right. group of people coming through the tube, if you want to mm-hmm. say that,
yeah.
that have zero interest in being a member of anything? They want to be engaged. They want to be involved in something, but they're not quote unquote membership mm-hmm. people. They're not going to send in their $35 and want a magazine. They're not going to do this. 15 years, 10 years from now, groups that I, at least my feeling is, groups that don't accept that and understand that are going to be less relevant than they are today.
Mm.
And, you know, I was watching you draw on that sheet of paper there, Shane, yeah. this curve of us old graybeards diminishing yeah. and being replaced with a different group.
Mm-hmm.
And that group that's going to replace us, they're as a reflection of total society. And Ted Carasotti is a friend of mine. He always is good at reminding me that, you know what, Randy, don't overthink it. Mm-hmm. Hunters are part of society. We're going to be just like the greater cross section of society in our habits, in our consumptions, in a lot of things, our behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, and maybe I'm wrong, no one will probably listen to this podcast 10 years from now, but I think 10 years from now, if I had to project that, to your point, Shane, there's going to be some group that emerges that understands this dynamic
mm-hmm.
of this younger generation of people having a care for wildlife, having a care for wild places, but they're not the traditional send me my magazine and my bumper sticker and here's my $35 every year.
No, it's a good point.
It may be a secret society, Randy.
which is not too far-fetched.
No, it's not.
So and I guess when I, you know, my son is in the millennials. He's 26. And he looks at me many times. He's like, Dad, you worry too much. Really? I do? He's like, it'll sort itself out. People will figure it out. But my generation, we're going to be fine. Don't worry about us. And you know, as a parent, you sit and fret about the future and the future and whether it's the future of conservation, the future of our country, whatever. And I do think that as a general, just an overall ability of people, maybe it's in this country, they adapt, they move forward, and there's always wreckage in the ditch, carnage of people who just didn't adapt, groups, organizations, ideas that are replaced by what you were saying, Shane, these new ideas, these new organizations. And I don't want to be, I don't want hunting and conservation to be one of those ideas that finds itself wrecked in the ditch because we didn't adapt, we didn't change, we were so stuck in our ways. Mm-hmm. Because I think that within every American, every human being, there is this absolute connection to wild places and wild things. Mm-hmm. It's just, how do we give them opportunities to express that? How do we give them opportunities to take action to make a difference? Mm-hmm. And I think it's there. We just got to start thinking about it in that context.
Or maybe it's not for us to think about. Maybe it's for those 19 and 20-year-olds to come up and decide what they're going to do themselves.
Well, let me give you an interesting example. Yeah. We moved to Bozeman. One of the reasons we moved to this great town is the youthfulness of it. You know, we've got Montana State University here. So we've brought on six new employees, many of them part-time, but two are MSU students. Mm-hmm. One's 19, one's 22. Over the earlier part of the summer, I was just kind of watching their interaction and thinking, God, I got these really bright minds. And so I challenged them to take an hour a day or 2-3 hours a week or 4 hours a week or five, whatever, I'm paying them. Get together and look at Wild Sheep Foundation critically. How are we messaging ourselves? What's our footprint? Are we reaching out to the people that we're getting?
Yeah.
But probably more importantly, how are we missing those that we're not? Mm-hmm. Mid-August, they came back and I asked them to give me a presentation. So mid-August, they brought us into this room, and you know, first and foremost, you know, here, you know, we're our, us dinosaurs. You know, we're pretty proud of our PowerPoint. these two, you know, young bright MSU students are using something called Prezi. I'd never seen it, and I mean it flows in and out, and I go, what the heck is that? Oh, well, it's Prezi. Oh, well, do I have to buy that? Oh, no, it's on the web. You know, it's a cloud based thing. I'm like, okay, well, you know, really exciting. These two young, you know, MSU students said, well, you know, first and foremost, we have a you know, disclaimer. Don't get mad about us or mad at us on what we're about ready to tell you. Their 20-minute presentation turned into 2 hours and 40 minutes. Mm-hmm. I was enthralled. We started reevaluating our mission statement. Just blinding flashes of brilliance came out of this that, you know, to them, you know, we talk about stakeholders. You know, we're stakeholders in the conservation community. We're stakeholders in the hunting community. To those two young minds, stakeholders was not an inclusive word. It was exclusive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They said, well, you know what? We're not stakeholders because we can't afford it. Oh, yeah. No. You have an interest. No, but a stakeholder's a shareholder, isn't it? Don't you have to buy in? But, you know, isn't that interesting?
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, so you know, we certainly don't have all the answers, but I'm looking to these young folks and listening to them. And Shane, I think you probably nailed it. They're going to be the ones that are going to show us the way. We just need to be receptive to, you know, to maybe follow. Or and adapt. You know, Randy, you're adapting to the, you know, now you're doing podcasts.
Yeah.
Well, what was a podcast 10 years ago?
I had no idea. And if there is a beautiful thing about my situation is I've hired a full-time production person, Marcus, who you guys mm-hmm. know. Mm-hmm. He's great 26.
Guy. Yeah.
So I've got all these millennials.
Yeah,
exactly.
They look at me like I am grandpa. I'm beyond grandpa. I am like so ready for the nursing home in how I consume media and what I do. But I'm trying to keep up with them.
Sure.
And yeah. it's it's given me a huge amount of optimism. I mean, in these podcasts, a lot of times we talk about, you know, kind of the gloominess and the darkness of this or that, but hanging around with these younger people has given me more optimism than anything I could do. Seeing how they consume media, seeing how adept they are at sorting the BS from the buckwheat.
Right.
They grew up in this media consumption world where everything's immediate. They're way better at sorting out what is BS versus what is relevant than I ever will be.
Right.
Because they've grown up in it. They've adapted in it. And their ability to share it instantaneously and share what's relevant versus what is irrelevant, I marvel at it. Yeah. And so I'm excited about it, quite honestly. And I know we've in this podcast, we've talked about kind of the challenges, but I am really excited about the opportunities that are there. And I'm very excited about the quality of the people and just the pureness of the motivation they have about conservation, about wild places and wild things, that if given the opportunities, given the funding, the platforms, the voice, they're going to lead. It you know, it's not something that happens tomorrow.
No.
But over time, I now view myself as...
Well, they must lead over time.
What's that?
They must lead over time.
Exactly, right. But I now view myself as almost more of a facilitator, a bridge from the old gray hairs to the to these millennials of how can I be some catalyst that helps and gives voice and...
Well, I think it's more than that, though. I mean, I think...
We need to be enablers.
Yeah, I think we do. But I also think we need to be a bit cautious here. One of the things that I think is innately true is fascination with wildlife. One of the things that is also true is that there is a growing global, and I believe there's a growing domestic view that conservation is important, certainly, but that there are different ways to get to the objective, which is to keep wildlife with us. And it's really important, I believe, that the passion of young people and the ingenuity that they possess and the faculties they possess in terms of communication and the media world that's we live in, we're media drenched, we're information drenched, is also coupled with an understanding that this business of conservation is about the most complicated business in the world.
It is.
And believe me, that's being lost in a lot of the debates that I attend. You know, conservation is a confluence of economics, politics, ecology, human desires and aspirations, cultural differences, deep feelings about the value of life and how we should interact with the rest of nature. We have to somehow find sense out of all of that to conserve both wildlife and, you know, progressive lives for human communities. And so I think one of the things that we do need to recognize as well, as I've pointed out with respect to hunter retention and recruitment programs or other things we have tried, you can have passion. You can have intellect. You can have facultative agility. You can have all of those kinds of things. But to me, one of the things that's critically important for conservation to be successful is to understand that ultimately it is a practical business. You cannot keep them with us just by dreams alone.
Right.
You have to put in place systems that work. They may be different in South Africa than North America. They may be different in Germany than they are in Canada. They may be, you know, but you have to have, not to sustain a sustainable world, you have to have sustainable mechanisms to achieve it. And so one of the concerns I have, even though I believe, as I've said, that brand new institutions will soon arise, they will be led by young people who have all of these talents that, you know, you and Gray have been talking about, Randy. I also believe that there's going to be a really important role for people who try to do what we do, is to continuously point out to them, think about the end product and how you're going to sustain that end product over time. Because you will have to make decisions about, no, we will not develop here, for example, for wildlife, and forgo the economic, you know, development and advantages. You will have to deal with the issues of, okay, well, can we keep wildlife here if we're going to have domestic livestock, let's say? And the decision might have to be, in some cases, unfortunately, we can't put wildlife there. I mean, it's a two-way street.
Right.
So I think this is something that I think about a lot. How do you capture that and that enthusiasm and that spirit and that capacity, and at the same time sort of say, just take a deep breath for a moment and realize that, you know, there isn't limitless land for wildlife anymore. It's no accident that they exist at all. It's not just because we love them.
Right.
And we want them, that they will be there. And I think that's going to be a big challenge for us in the next, well, it's a challenge now, internationally especially. I mean, you have people in North America who won't tolerate a cricket in their house.
Right.
Without calling the exterminator or leaping up onto their counter or their bed, who will expect people in rural Africa to live with lions and elephants.
Right.
They have the passion.
Right.
They have the interest. They're often highly intelligent, highly successful people who love wildlife,
right.
But they're requesting a completely unsustainable model for the protection of wildlife. And right. I think that's a big issue, Randy.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think those are lessons that we will teach, we'll learn, we don't have it all figured out. I mean,
oh, come on now.
But I mean, they're just,
that's an insult, right?
Yeah. Well, I've kept you guys a long time, and I apologize for that, but I can listen to you guys talk for hours and hours. So hopefully we didn't put any listeners asleep as they were driving down the road, and I'll be held responsible for them crashing in the ditch or something. But
you did talk about crashes and ditches.
I know. Yeah. But before we leave, Shane, I just, can you give us a quick update about your Wild Harvest initiative, where it's at? But our listeners have heard about it on past podcasts, but
well, fortunately, with the support of a lot of organizations like the Wild Sheep Foundation and others, this project continues to grow and to mature. We now have NGOs as supporters. We have some industry, and we're hoping to attract more. And we now have state governments and agencies becoming involved. We have the state of Florida already firmly committed to a 5-year program, and we have very productive discussions about to be finalized with other states. We're seeing a great deal more interest in it. The data compilation, where we're gathering all the data from state and provincial agencies, is going very well. We have built a brand new database for this that's able to capture all this data and will allow us to manipulate it. We have our first graduate students starting on the program already. And if the progress continues, then I think people will begin to see a real step up in the public relations aspect of this, the outreach aspect of it. But, you know, we've had articles in Outdoor Life. We've had several articles in Sports Afield, a new one in there, this edition now that's coming out, this volume. A lot of interest from, you know, people like yourself, Randy, who have mechanisms to get the message out, interviews by radio, television, newspapers. So I have to say that, I'm very optimistic that we're going to be able to provide to, you know, this continent and the rest of the world an understanding that, you know, 40 million people in our two countries still harvest sustainably a huge amount of organic food from the natural world because people 100 years ago made fantastic decisions about, you know, how we would live with wildlife and how we would protect them and how we would have them not just sustain themselves but also sustain us spiritually, emotionally, intellectually, and in this particular case, physically. So thanks for asking, but it is going really well, and I appreciate you know, you're helping get the word out about it.
Sure. So people can find out more about it at Conservation Vision.
Yes, they can. Just go to conservationvisions.com. They'll see it. And pretty soon, as I said, I think they'll see wider reach coming out through a variety of media sources. It takes money, obviously, and support to be able to engage those kinds of mechanisms, as you well know.
Yeah.
But we're using all the mechanisms that we possibly can. And, you know, one of the things that I'm doing here in Bozeman this week, and Gray has been really helpful in setting up a lot of discussions with organizations that might become, that are potential new partners or sponsors in one way or another, financially or otherwise.
Yeah.
And we find we're being, you know, people are contacting us from kind of strange places that, you know, we didn't speak directly to and have heard about it and are coming to us and wondering about it and asking how they can become involved. So it has the potential to be a very significant thing. And so far, yet again, the American institutions and the American people, the American organizations are immediately stepping up in very selfless ways and saying, you know, it's a good idea, it's good for conservation, it's good for hunting, and we should support it. You know, that doesn't happen everywhere in the world.
Yeah.
It's another reminder to me, and people have heard me say this many times from the stage, but, you know, this country really does have an extraordinary capacity to give and do great things, and I see it all the time. And, I mean, you know, I come from the island of Newfoundland, I come into this country with these kinds of ideas, and there's no sense that, you know, hey, well, you know, we didn't think of it, so we're not going to do it. Or, you know, why don't we just do it ourselves? Or, you know, well, you know, why would we give you support for this? Why don't we take it on as, you know, a sheep foundation or an elk foundation or something? Yeah. So, you know, in addition to the benefits, hopefully, that it will deliver itself, it has, from a personal point of view, already delivered something to me again, which is an indication that, you know, this spirit of Roosevelt still lives in this nation.
Yeah. Well, that's great to hear, and I hope it lives forever in this nation.
Yeah. I think this initiative is one way that it can.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And before we leave, Gray, anything about the State of the Union of the Wild Sheep Foundation you want to, that I missed? I mean, I've got pages of notes here, and we hardly got to a couple of them, so.
Well, this event that we're doing tonight, I think, is indicative of the State of the Wild Sheep Foundation outreach.
Yeah.
You know, obviously we have an iconic animal, game animal, that we focus on. But it's, as we've been discussing the last two and a half hours, it's so much broader than just a particular species. It's the survival of all of them, and quite frankly, it's the survival of us. So, you know, Shane spoke many, many years ago, and something that I one of those little nuggets of wisdom that I picked up on his conservation necklace. So we've been running around Bozeman introducing him to some of our industry partners, but tonight we're reaching out to a very broad community. Hunters, non-hunters, people just interested in you know, what is this Wild Harvest Initiative? So right. those are the kind of things that Wild Sheep Foundation is doing now. We still continue to focus on what is our mission, and, you know, putting and keeping sheep on the mountain. You know, we spend about $4 million a year on programs directly benefiting wild sheep. But we need to adapt.
Yeah.
You know, that's obviously what we started to do back in 1977. That's what we've done well. But our eyes are open. And we will adapt. I firmly believe in it, and it's my goal that the Wild Sheep Foundation isn't one of those organizations, as Shane has spoken, that becomes irrelevant.
Yeah.
We want to be at the forefront on making not only the hunter relevant, but most importantly, conservation relevant, because that's who we are. That's what we do. And that's why we exist.
Yeah. Well, you guys are doing a hell of a job with it so far.
Well, we need to get you a sheep too, Randy. We need to kick you out of that less than one club.
Well, you know, whatever random parts of the universe have to line up for Randy to draw a sheep permit, I'm happy if it does, but if it doesn't, I've still got my shoulder to the wheel for the cause of sheep conservation.
Absolutely, and you do, and we appreciate it.
And I hope that everybody listening to this realizes the value of what groups do. And we talked about how small of a percentage of people are the, you know, percentage of the hunters are those who are active and engaged. And my whole goal, and pretty much all the things I talk about, all the things I do, is getting more people engaged, because I'm a firm believer that as we shrink as a percentage of society, the burden on every one of us to keep moving conservation forward, we all have to shoulder a little heavier load. It's just, we can say, well, that's not how my dad did it, or how grandpa did it, or how Jack did it. Well, guess what? It's just the reality of what we deal with today. And if we really want to walk the walk and talk the talk, we better put our shoulder to the wheel. And it's going to require a lot of people pushing on that conservation wagon to keep it going up the hill. So,
well, Randy, if there's folks out there that want to put the shoulder to the wheelbarrow or pull on the rope of the Wild Sheep Foundation, they can go to wildsheepfoundation.org and join our family, because it is a family.
Yeah.
And I'm glad that you're part of it.
Yeah, I'm glad to be, and thanks. You know, I don't know, did you guys have to like review my membership application or anything? Was it like tenuous whether or not you'd accept this character?
You know, we do have that black bean policy.
Okay.
And we just made sure that the guy that had the black bean wasn't in the meeting.
All
so
right.
he didn't throw it on the table. Now we're fortunate to have you as a member, and Shane, we're fortunate to have you as a life member. We appreciate that.
Well, Absolutely. Folks, thanks for listening. This is always a great conversation, talk about conservation. I know that a lot of you might think we spend too much time on it, but it's where the future lies. And
amen.
Without a future of conservation, there's really no future for wildlife and no future for hunting. So thanks for listening, folks. I don't know who we'll have next week, but the odds are it's going to be from the wilds of my elk camp. It's going to be a live, not a live podcast. It's going to be an in-the-field podcast. So stay tuned and listen for that one. Thanks for listening.